Hey friends, Derek from TCI here with another video to help you learn network cable management. In this example, we're going to be building out a small office. Let me show you the space that I'm working in. We're pretty far along in construction here. I've been brought in near the end to terminate all of the Cat6 wires that the installers have left me. In terms of offices and endpoints, we're looking at about 25 people plus printers. When the installers did the cables for me, the grand total ended up being approximately 73 wires. They're of different colors for different purposes. Because this is a live construction site with different trades coming and going, the installers have left all of the cables in the ceiling for me to retrieve. It will be my job to bring these wires down the wall and install them in a frame on this backboard. After getting my tools together, my first order of business is to bring the wires down from the ceiling. I'm standing a little high on this short ladder, so when you go through this same step, make sure you use an appropriately sized ladder. I was being lazy and unsafe. This is not something you want to replicate. Once I have all the wires down out of the ceiling, I'm going to build something called a chase pipe. This is meant to go at the top of the backboard. It's a 4-inch pipe, and I've got two of them. The goal here is to create an entry path from the ceiling space, called the plenum area, into the lower space. I don't like the look of ragged holes in the ceiling tiles, so I put these pipes here before the ceiling tradesman arrives. When he finds these pipes, he will cut an outline around his tiles so that this fits. This is probably a good time to mention that whenever I am transitioning cables from one space to another, I like to have something like a grommet or a chase pipe or other indicator that I meant to make that hole. It's usually not my desire to take a knife and cut a jagged hole out of the ceiling or drill and penetrate drywall. As much as possible, I make it look like I intended to do that all along because I believe that this increases the professionalism of the final product. With the chase pipes installed, I will now begin to remove the tape on the Cat6 that the installers have left behind.
Hey friends, you're probably wondering at this point, what do we do with all of this? Well, I did label them. They're all labeled. But the realities of a construction site are that you've got to stay out of the way of the other tradesmen sometimes. So these were run more or less at random by different people, different times. So sometimes there'd be painters in the way, there'd be flooring guys. So different sections of this job site were run at different times. And if you're wondering, how do we get this combed and looking beautiful? There's no trick to it. There's nothing glamorous. Everybody in every other video is not showing you what I'm about to do, which is you go through these label by label and you undo it and you put them back in order and then you comb them. So there's nothing to it but to do it, so let's get started.
In a perfect world, I would have had the installers run these in numerical order and organize them in groups of 24 for me. However, just wasn't possible on this job. That's okay, a little bit of elbow grease and we'll get them sorted out. I've located my first 24, so I'm going to comb them right away. Your cable comb, as I may have stated in another video, is a tool that you thread all your wires into, and then you pull it down in order to organize them in a beautiful braid. However, you don't need this tool if you don't have one. Just use your hand and some Velcro, secure the braid as you pull downwards, and you won't have any trouble making a really nice bundle here.
Okay, friends, I've reached the end of my first comb. All of these I'm going to tape up and taper so that they can get through the chase pipe. And then most of this length here, this is all going to be cut. So I'm going to wrap this piece up in tape, and then I'm going to start on the next 24. I think I'll just transition to that one. I'll spare you guys that. Okay.
There we go, all done, and you didn't have to watch me. Now I will bring them through the chase pipe. Here is the rack that our client supplied us. It's 12 rack units. It's an open frame. And he's arranged it himself so that the cage nuts are not used, that we will instead be using the tapped holes. These open frames present a lot of difficulties. They don't have any features for cable management, and there's no side panel or top panel that you can use to cover up any unsightly rigging you may have had to do to make this work. In order to mount this frame on the wall, the first thing I do is get my cables out of the way. I do this by Velcroing them to an overhanging pipe that's up above my head temporarily so that it clears the backboard in order for me to apply the screws. In order to install the frame on the backboard by myself, I first drill a single screw on the upper left of where my frame will be. I don't put it in all the way, just enough so that it can hold some weight. I then carry that frame up onto the ladder and put its first hole through that screw in order that it will hold the weight for me. That gives me a chance to sink a second screw and get my level going. After I've verified that my frame is on the wall in a level way, I'll go get some washers, and then I will reapply the screws one by one with the washers to properly lock it onto this plywood. After I'm satisfied that the frame will not fall off the wall and is secure, I will begin to attach the elements that are important here. I'll start with the patch panels. You can see here in this diagram that I am following a plan, so I will map what is on my plan to the rack units on the front of this frame. During this phase of the build, I will only be installing the panels so that I can terminate with as much freedom of movement as possible. After I am done terminating, I will begin to install the cable manager and the associated switches. The cables that I have hanging, I will now begin to bring into the inside of my frame. I combed these in groups of 24 so that it would be easier for me to show you how I manage these cables. When you bundle them in groups of 48, one per panel, it is really difficult to manage it. Now's my favorite part. This is where I put in a standard rack shelf upside down so that it has more stiffness and the supporting lip for the equipment is facing downwards and not bothering my arms while I try to terminate. I like to do this temporarily so that I have a work surface while I'm putting this frame together. In order to begin my terminations, I'm going to start with the bundle that is intended to go to the lowest panel. In order to properly manage the length of the cables as I terminate them, I make use of the empty sockets within these unloaded patch panels. Once I have every cable in this bundle in position, I will Velcro it to keep it in place. I will then Velcro it on the rear as well so that it cannot accidentally fall out of its socket while I am terminating one of the other ones. Here is an up-close shot of the first panel I'll be working on now that I have all the wires in position and properly Velcroed. Okay, let's get our tools out. I'm going to be using an all-in-one crimp tool along with these jacks that are compatible with it. I really prefer this method as it's great for beginners and you make a lot less mistakes doing it this way. As you watch me terminate, try and imagine what this would look like if this was a punch-down block and you had a Fluke punch tool, then you were trying to do this by the rear. It would be quite a bit more difficult to manage the length of the cables. Many of my competitors and friends that work in this industry have settled on a particular brand of all-in-one crimp tool. You might look into doing something similar for your projects. With my first panel complete, I'm going to start to roll my slack back up into the ceiling. Some people like to leave their service loop down below the ceiling where they can see it. But I think that it looks more aesthetically pleasing when you cannot see the extra slack. Notice that the only visible wires are what is needed to reach the panel. Everything else I have hiding in the ceiling. Now that I've got my slack out of the way, I will secure my bundle with additional Velcro. I don't want to put anything that could cause strain on my panel. With that first panel out of the way, I'm then going to grab the next 24 cables and start on the row above that. You can see here that I'm repeating the process of bringing my cables through the unloaded patch panel ports in order to manage their length. Once I have all of them through, I'm going to apply Velcro again so that they don't fall out on accident. And then I will begin terminating once again. For this row, I'm just going to transition to this being magically terminated. Here we go. The cables turn out pretty uniform if you use the unloaded panel to guide the length. And if you tuck the rest up into the ceiling as a service loop, it tends to look pretty good even if you're a beginner. Before I start my third and final panel, it's become apparent that my temporary Velcro just isn't gonna hack it anymore. So I'm going to switch to these saddle straps in order to permanently zip tie these to the backboard. Whenever you zip tie a group of cables, make sure that you are doing so gently. Don't force it down as tight as you possibly can because this is bad for the cables. Just use enough to give it some strain relief. Let's finish up by doing the final set of 24. By now you should have a pretty good idea of the pattern that I'm doing, so I'll just speed right through this. If you've managed to get this far within your own project, go ahead and give yourself a hand and take a much-needed break. Before I wrap up for the day, I need to inspect this bundle and make sure that nothing is drooping. So I'll go through and make sure that everything is as horizontal as I can possibly make it, making sure that my zip ties are helping me out and my Velcro is secure. As you can see in this profile shot, I'm looking to make sure that there is room for my switches and my cable managers, and that the cables themselves are not actually drooping onto them. I'm going to pause here for the day, but before I go, it's very important to clean up any evidence that I was here working. I don't want the project manager or general contractor or any other tradesman to have to clean up my mess. I've been away for a few days, and now that I've come back to the job site, I barely recognize it. The construction team has made a lot of progress. To finish out this frame, I'm going to be getting all of my equipment ready. I've got cable managers, patch cords, switches, and a router that I need to install here today. I'm going to begin this process by installing my switches first. Whenever you're installing something heavy in the rack, use the bottom screw holes on the rack ears to make sure that it comes out level. Also, I was given a tip by one of the YouTube commenters in a previous video that you should install screws just below where you intend to put your equipment, and those screws can hold the weight by leaving the rack ears on those. There we go, got all the switches in place. Next, I'm going to install the router that the client has supplied me. It's not my favorite kind, it's a really low-end sonic wall in a rack adapter. This unit is not normally rackable, so you'll see me struggle quite a bit here to get this thing to line up properly. Once that's out of the way, I'll begin to install my cable managers. The type of cable manager that I'm using is called a knee patch. This type has a deep back that allows me to hide cable slack and other loose items inside of it. When I'm using an open frame system, it's a lot easier for me to be able to hide unsightly elements inside this deep channel. With the final cable manager in place, you can see that my rack is really starting to look like something finally. Now I'm going to link my switches together with a fiber patch cord. I was initially going to use a DAC cable, however I discovered that because those things are very finicky, the one that I happen to have on hand just wasn't compatible with my switches. No problem. I'll just bring the fiber patch through the rear of my knee patch and then bring it in through the finger duct. I'll show you another angle on that when I get a moment, but for now, I'm going to begin patching in the bottom panel. I'm starting there because there are the fewest cables here and it's easiest to manage. If I'm going to run into a problem, I like to know early. I start from port one and I go in groups of two, rolling the slack into the neat patch each time I patch something in. Here's the cable manager from the front now that I'm done. I didn't run into any problems with length, cables reaching, things looking ugly, etc. So I'm going to start on the larger panel up top. As you watch me patch this one in, you might be wondering why didn't I use 6-inch patch cords and eliminate the cable manager altogether. You could totally do that if this is your rack. In my case, I had no say over what switches the customer is going to provide me. And when I don't know what I'm going to deal with in terms of equipment, I always bring a cable manager with at least 2U and some slack in the back where I can roll things up. And that way, I can handle pretty much anything that the customer throws at me. Here's what the full 48-port panel looks like from the front. I'm almost completely done with this project. The last thing to do is to patch in the router to the switch. I'm going to try to do this one-handed so that I can show you how I'm routing this cable through the rear of the neat patch and then again in through the front of the finger ducts. With the router patched in, I'll show you a profile view. What I'm trying to highlight here is that there are no extraneous cables drooping or dragging or leaning or in any way being unsightly here in this rack. There's still plenty more to do here, but my job is over. The customer has their own technology staff that is going to install a UPS beneath this rack, and they're also going to hook up the internet provider's connection. I'm not going to be a part of that, so this is where the video ends for me. Well, that's it for this build. I got plenty more coming, so there'll be more videos. Thank you for hanging out with me. Appreciate it. I'll see you in the next one.